Facebook land. can tell that we actually have people in our sanctuary like we've had in the past few weeks. So we are, our numbers are increasing, which is a good thing. It's a good thing. We have, I think I counted 14, 15 people here this morning. I might have miscounted. I ran out of fingers and thumbs, so I got more than what I had here, so I couldn't take off my shoes. So. But we're gonna join together in some worship. We have some contemporaries, some hymns, so please, as you're home, use this time to meditate and worship with us and praise the Lord.
I take the Father's love.
things. I don't think Facebook Live was really meant for churches to use per se, but the customer service is very difficult to communicate. So we may be shifting to a different live stream medium. We may end up going toward a YouTube Live in the next few weeks. So we're going to work on that, and because our videos are muted when they go on Facebook because of the music, even though we have the licensing. So we're working on that. So bear with us, those of you who are at home and sharing with your friends. If the video is muted, that's why. We're trying to work on that. And like I said, the most practical solution we've come to thus far seems to be that we need to shift live streaming. So we'll let you guys know and keep you in the loop on that. Second thing is, today's Father's Day. Yay! Yay! Oh, no one's excited except for me. All right, and Daniel. Thanks, Daniel. Appreciate your candor. So today's Father's Day, so we celebrate Father's Day, but this is a unique Father's Day because Mother's Day we were unable to be in the sanctuary. I know Brittany and Daniel and I were here live streaming, but we were not allowed to come together at church per se. So today we're not just celebrating fathers, but we're also celebrating mothers again. Because mothers, they keep their kahuna that hold everything together, right?
Amen.
I only got one amen on that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. You gotta speak up so everybody at home can hear you. We got that. We are still, like I said, we have a website for those of you who have friends that you want to reference for our sermons. If they don't have Facebook or if you want to hear the video that's not muted, send them to our website. The church service is always on the website via YouTube. On our website, I put it on every week. So, and for those of you who are here, see what happens when you come to church, you get special gifts. For those of you who are here and you're a mother and a father, we have a little basket, two baskets set up in the back. There's one that says fathers and there's one that says mothers. And the gifts inside of there are kind of specific to fathers and mothers. So as you're going out try to keep cleanliness and sanitation and stuff together like we're supposed to, we're going to have you pick your little gift as you go out. It'll be on the right-hand side as you walk out the door. For those of you who at home who are coming to church frequently here, if you'd like to give and contribute to our ministry, there are a couple different ways. You can go online to our website and go to our giving page, www.darlingtonbaptistnc.org, and go to giving, and you can choose to give via there. You click on the link, and it'll put you to a secure website to do that. Or you can write a check and mail it to the church, 11658 Justice Branch Road, Littleton, North Carolina, 27850. I've got that address memorized now, I think. And you can also, if you can also put it in our mailbox, and Kathy checks that regularly during the week. So I think that's all the announcements this morning, I believe, perhaps. Everybody doesn't see that? Okay, I guess I covered them all. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer. And what I want us to pray for today is a few specific things. As we meditate on the Lord through corporate prayer, I want us to contemplate a couple things. I want us to contemplate how grateful we are and thankful we are to be able to be in church. Regardless of where we're at, for whatever reason, those of you who choose to stay home, we accept that and we appreciate that. But be thankful for where we are and who we're worshiping this morning. And another thing I want us to think of and be contemplating, think of the challenge that the Bible gives to fathers. What it means to be a father. What it means to be a man in accordance with church. Be in mind and thought of that this morning as we pray for the Lord. Let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you today. We are so grateful for who you are and what you've done in our lives and in this world. Because we recognize you as a sovereign creator. One who exists outside of creation so that you can be glorified and worshiped because you are above all and in all. So we praise you and we thank you for who you are and what you've done. We are so very grateful for the opportunity to gather together in corporate worship again. We do know that there are still some precautions that need to be made, and some people might not feel 100% comfortable because of the uniqueness of this virus and pandemic that we're suffering with. But we know that you have not given us a spirit of timidity or fear, but we, through you, have strength. But we also have been given wisdom and discernment to make sure that we take proper precautions, and you've allowed us to do just that. So we do thank you for giving us these guidelines to use, and we thank you for those who have decided to come to worship you in person today in the church. We're so very thankful and grateful for that. Today, as we celebrate Father's Day, we look to you as the song that Chris Conlon sang a few moments ago. We look to you as a good, good father. You are a perfect example of what a father is and what a father does. You are loving yet stern. You are faithful, yet you punish us and chastise us when we need it. You are all in all, everything we could ever possibly imagine. Every word that's been used on the face of this planet to describe fatherhood, you embody all of that. And we as fathers can only aspire to be as good as you. In fact, in our Christian progress, our goal is to be like you in all things. We pray that today as we worship you in mind and in body and spirit, that you lift us up and encourage us. Help us to be the people that you called us to be. But more importantly, help us realize that this is just one small part of a life of discipleship and worship to you. Be with us as we come together today to glory and honor you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I think we're going to sing the doxology now, right? I told Brittany the reason we have to sing it is because that's what I know I'm supposed to preach next. Keep me in line. So if you would, those of you at home and those of you here, if you could stand with us so we can sing the doxology and show reverence to the Lord. Thank you so much.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Calls him a sermon and takes six people to take up all the money. appreciate you guys humor and laughing at that. That's the same joke I told 2 years ago on Father's Day. I'm glad you guys still find it humorous. I didn't ask Lisa, I didn't run it by her, but I ran it by her the first time and she said it was okay. So, I'm going to be reading from, like I said, Ephesians 5, 22 through 33. And this passage of scripture, going into the first part of chapter 6, we're going to see today's Father's Day, but most, you couldn't be a father unless you have a wife, right? So you got to be a husband, okay? Everybody pretty much agreed with that. And then, as a father, you're not only a husband, but you're a father of children, so you're supposed to be an example. So we're going to read quite a few verses here, and I want to share with us a few points this morning. So let's read together from Ephesians 5, starting in verse 22. We're going to go through the first few verses of chapter 6. He says, "Wives, be subject to your own husbands, as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is also the head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. But as the church is subject to Christ, so also the wives are to be subject to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church, and gave himself up for her, so that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the world. Excuse me, with the word. That he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and blameless. So husbands ought to also love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ also does the church, because we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his mother and father, and shall be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is great, but I am speaking with reference to Christ and the church. Nevertheless, each individual among you is also to love his own wife even as himself, and the wife must see to it that she respects her husband." And then in chapter 6, he says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may be well with you, that you may live long on the earth. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord." Let's pray together. Father God, we do thank you for this time that we have to go into your word. This letter that Paul wrote to the church in Ephesus, you've given us today to use it to bring practical application to our lives. So I pray that's what we do today. We don't just look at this as a challenge that Paul gave to a church almost 2,000 years ago, but we look at this as a challenge that he gives to us today, because we know that the Word of God lives forever and it transcends time and space. We know that these words that he wrote to them so many years ago can be applicable to our lives today. So we pray that today, as we go through the passage of Scripture and we challenge fathers, I pray we are challenged. I pray our toes get stepped on. I pray that we feel convicted over the inefficiencies that we have in our lives and the limits that we have placed on ourselves in our lives to serve the world and not serve you. So today I pray that we are lifted up and encouraged to know that there is hope, that we can always change the way we do business to serve you and only you and all that we do. And I pray these blessings over this message today, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So let's start a little bit. I said this outline from a couple years ago, because this is the same sermon I preached 2 years ago from the same passage of Scripture. But I wanted to change it up a little bit. I wanted to talk about family discipleship. I wanted to talk about family discipleship this morning. We could go over a couple of Greek words, we can make it sound really flowery and really good about what the literal interpretation of those words is, but the biggest thing about preaching is teaching people how to apply what it says here into our everyday lives, amen? That's our job as pastors, that's our job as lay leaders, that's our job as fathers, is to take what's written in here and exemplify it and model it so that our wives and our children have an example to follow. I pose to you a statement this morning that the reason why there's problems in the United States today is because fathers have failed in doing their jobs.
Amen.
Okay, I just want to make sure you guys heard, I heard the headline, but for all the people at home, I want to let everybody know at home that everybody agrees with me. And the thing is that I've been challenged this week is because I fail as a father. I fail as a father. I don't have patience. I get angry. I fail as a husband because I don't treat my wife as I should. Sometimes I don't speak to her with the respect that she deserves. Sometimes I don't honor her with my thoughts. Sometimes I don't honor her with my actions. Sometimes I am a human being all the time. And because of that, I am flawed. But I challenge each and every one of you sitting here today, listening at home, that are men, we are all flawed. That is why Paul writes these words to us. For instance, he says, agapao, have a sincere appreciation or high regard for. He says, have a sincere appreciation or high regard for. That's what it means to love. Have a sincere appreciation or high regard. I'm going to say that again. A sincere appreciation or high regard. How many of us as husbands have a sincere appreciation or a high regard for our wives? How many? Do we have a sincere appreciation and a high regard? Because I challenge you today to think real deep on this topic and ask yourselves, if I don't have a high appreciation, a high regard, and a deep self-sacrificing love for my wife, how in the world can I expect her to love me? How can we expect our wives to love us? Because, you know, the challenge isn't that women love their husbands, but they respect their husbands. Because women are more loving and nurturing by nature. Everybody agree with that? Just the way God made you. Just like God made men heartless and cold. Right? That's why we're disciplinarians in our homes most of the time. Right? I wanted a friend, I get a dog. I have one. I'm not friends with him either. Right? But if we don't model the type of behavior with our wives and our marriage that God's given us on this earth, this beautiful picture of what our relationship with Jesus Christ should look like as the bride of Christ, as the body of Christ, as the church, then how in the world can we teach our children how they should act? Now, I know that there are out there in Facebook land and here in the church, there might be some differences and some mistakes people have made in their lives. And I'm not trying to belittle or beat down or exasperate anybody here this morning. I just come today to preach the truth. Because if we think back and we look back at our lives, if we're old enough to think back 30, 40, 50 years, I'm not that old, so I can't go back that far. Maybe 40, that's pretty close. But if we look back at our lives and see the mistakes that we've made, we can see the repercussions of those mistakes in the lives of our children. Can we not? Can we not see it? Whether you've been married once or five times, you can see when you look back that when you failed in your marriage, you failed in your raising of your children. And we can see that. I'm a product of a divorced family. I was in foster care for 5 years. I could have very easily said the system owes me something because I was slighted in the very formative years of my life. But I did not. You know why? Because God rests in me, and all of the fulfillment I have, I find in Him. And we should be the same. All of us. Because we are all inherently flawed human beings. And if we elevate our spouses to a point where we expect them to fulfill all of our needs, we've elevated them to a position of failure. Both husbands and wives alike. I know that there's a culture here, and our culture in our house is very similar. My wife does everything. She washes the clothes. She makes me fold my own clothes. But she washes the clothes. She folds the clothes. I put my own clothes away, but sometimes she does when I'm too lazy. You know, she cooks, she cleans, she keeps the house, she gets the kids washed and fed, and I grill on the grill, and I think I've done something. It takes time to put the charcoal in the chimney and light the paper and watch to make sure it don't burn the house down. And it takes time to flip the burgers, but who's in there prepping all the side stuff? The wife. Unless we grill asparagus, and I have this little grill basket I can put on my grill, that I've done something extra. I clean the litter boxes every once in a while, and I think I've done something extra. I do these other little chores, but when are we going to realize as men that in order for us to have a sincere appreciation and high regard and cherish our wives, that we should not expect them to do those things, but we should honor them by working alongside her when she does those things? Unless your wife's like mine, she takes care of the kitchen. I'm trying to make light, I'm making a little lighthearted jest at some of these things, because I want us to understand that women and men are different creations, joined together by only one person who can make it happen and keep it together, and that's God. Amen? Only one person on this planet can make a marriage work. Even those people who don't believe in God, that don't believe He exists, they embody these same instructions that Paul gives to men in the book of Ephesians. I know several people who don't believe in Jesus Christ. They don't even believe in God, but they're married. And they have prosperous marriages. You know why? Because these principles and qualities that are written in this book are not strictly for Christians. They're for everybody to live by. And the sad part is that people who don't believe in God embody these characteristics more so than the Christians that claim that they believe in God. How messed up is that? You want to know why we have failures in marriages? Because people are selfish. They don't know how to come together and communicate. Instead, they want to butt heads. Verse 28, he says, "So husbands also ought to love their wives as their own body. He who loves his own wife loves himself. For no one has ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes it and cherishes it, just as Christ nourishes it, just as Christ also does the church." How do we nourish our spouse? Men, how do we nourish our wives? How do we do that? What does that look like? Well, you know, it may look differently for you, Richard, or for me, Justin, or for you, Freddie, or for you, Charlotte, or for you, different. It might look different. The practical application of that might be different in everybody's household. But the one foundation remains the same. If you stay faithful to God, He will be faithful to you. If you stay faithful to God, He will be faithful to you. The sad part is we often take the place of God in our households. I'm the king. I wish I had a pulpit. I was sturdy. I could have banged on it just now. I'm the patron. That's what I say in my house. That's what my dad used to say. I'm the king. I hate to tell you, hate to tell myself and tell all you guys out there, you ain't nothing without Jesus. The moment we elevate ourselves to a position of authority over other people in our house, our wives, our children, or whatever, that's called lording it over them, and the Bible specifically calls out against that. We must do so in Christian love, because men have a walking paradox every day. We are called by God to be the leaders of our house. We are called by God to be accountable to Him for what we do in our house with our wives and our children, but you know what? We can't lord it over them. So how in the world are we as flawed human beings supposed to lead our households if we're not supposed to beat them over the head and crack the whip and make them do what we say? How are we supposed to do that with love? Model it. Exemplify Christ in your lives. This is not an easy sermon for me to preach. Because everything I just said, I'm guilty of. I hope I'm not in solitary company. You know, I took a family discipleship class since I was finishing seminary a few months ago. It's been 6 months since I finished. I'm so excited. There's a guy named Paul David Tripp. He's wrote many books. One of the books we used in this biblical counseling class that I took in January, February as a addendum to studying, trying to learn how to better counsel people with family discipleship type stuff. Discipleship with others. Paul David Tripp writes a couple different books. One of the books he writes is Instruments. I forget the title of it. I can't remember. It's the bust. Instruments, basically, it's God uses imperfect people to counsel imperfect people. He also writes a book called 14 Gospel Principles for Raising Your Children. Ted and Margie Tripp, I don't know if they're related. I didn't study it long enough, but they write books about shepherding the child's heart. The reason we fail, men, in our jobs as husbands and fathers, is because we take on the responsibility, we take on the authority, we take on the power, and we leave God in the backseat. You know, the love in verse 25, husbands, love your wives like a pa'o. It's an action. We're supposed to act out our love for our wives. It, doesn't just suggest an action, it demands an action. Demands an action. And if we don't know what true love is, the reason why Jesus Christ uses marriage as a picture of the body of Christ, aka the church, in himself, he is the groom, the husband, and the church is the bride, and he uses that imagery so that we could get a clue on how we're supposed to live our lives as husbands and treat our wives, which reminisces the church. Laying ourselves down for them. You know, I struggle because I'm like, man, I go to work, I sweat, I work all day or whatever the case may be. And then my wife said, yeah, you can come home at 4 o'clock or whatever, and I'm still working. I'm like, yeah, but you take more breaks every day than I do. And it's not hot. It's always a 74 or 75 degrees in the house. It's not 100 outside. None of that really matters. None of that really matters. The moment we start comparing what each other does, we've already lost. Both sides. Because if we're willing to accept that God made us differently, then why on earth do we want to compare to each other? Because we're not. It's not comparable. You can't compare a husband to your wife and say, well, I've done this, so you should do that. That's not how this works. Who cares if you've got to do a little bit extra? And it says, wives ought to respect their husbands. That means wives can't nag their husbands. I'm blessed to not have a nagging wife. Proverbs says it's better to live on a rooftop than in a house with a nagging wife. It says scornful, but it means nagging. He says it like 4 times in the book of Proverbs, so obviously it was a problem back then too, gentlemen. It doesn't just exist today. Huh? You with me? But let's ask ourselves a question. And I'm speaking in practical layman's terms here today. This isn't going to be some flowery Greek sermon like it normally is. But in all honesty, why is your wife nagging you? Because you ain't doing something you were supposed to do. Hello? I got one in the back. But you know, nagging is not respect. If you're supposed to reverence your husband, that your church is supposed to reverence Jesus. If you're supposed to respect your husband, that your church is supposed to respect and honor Jesus. Why would you nag? This is a touchy-feely sermon here today because both parties are bad. But you know where it stems from? Whose shoulders does it fall on? Don't fall on the wife's. Falls on the husband. You know why God created marriage to be a man and a woman? Because that's the way he designed it. Because men are held to a higher standard. They're the ones who have to bear the brunt of the punishment. They're the ones who have to answer for why their household won't work right. They're the ones who are supposed to lead. They're the ones who are supposed to be the teachers in the house, not the women. Look at our church. Look at the churches all across America. There's women doing everything because men are lazy. They admit there are less men in church than there are women. That's a sad fact. That's a sad fact. You look at the choir, our choir is different. We have half and half. Majority of choirs are from men up there. It's all women folk. Look at the leadership of the church. There's no men. You can't even get men to volunteer to anything. Why? They can volunteer to do every single thing else in the community, but they can't come to church to serve. Why? You want to know why there's no young people in the church? Because the men haven't stepped up and become the leaders in the church. They haven't modeled anything. So then we wonder why men aren't following in footsteps. Because they have no example. The very foundation of society is the nuclear family. The term nuclear came out in the 50s, I believe it was, right after World War II. Man, woman, children. Didn't specify how many. Just man, woman, children. That's the nuclear family. You know what happened to society when you take the man out of the household? Look at back all the way back to the 60s. Now I'm going to preach something that's going to be very sensitive here, and it's not motivated by any personal prejudice or racism or anything like that. But in the 1960s, they took the black man out of the household, and the black family has crumbled ever since. There's a website called fatherhood.gov that gives you all the statistics on it. You want to know how they take the white man out of the family? By promoting gay and lesbianism. That's how they take the white man out of the white family. Satan is attacking this world by removing the central figure that holds the family. and that's the man and the husband. When you remove them out of the foundation of the family, your whole society will crumble. Look around and tell me if I'm wrong. Now, I hate to be so dogmatic about very specific details because I don't want people misunderstanding what I'm telling you. And those of you at home, please understand that I'm not trying to speak out against any race, creed, or anybody else. I'm just speaking facts. People can argue whatever they want with the prison system and this system and everything like that, but you look at society and you look at the history over the last 60 to 70 years and you see that when the father is removed from the home, the husband is removed from the home, the family falls apart. Now, was it possible to overcome that? Absolutely, because with God, all things are possible. But the majority of the people will not overcome it because they don't have somebody at home being the stern figure that needs to be there to model the type of behavior that needs to be modeled. Woman was not made to raise a child alone. Period, case closed. Man was not raised to raise a child alone. Period, case closed. They were made to raise children together. It's not easy being a man. There's a lot of responsibility that falls on our shoulders. And we let it fall off and go to somebody else. We give it away. You know, I work for a union job in the railroad, and I'm gonna make an analogy here. Because I work in a union, I'm not allowed to do somebody else's work. If I give my work away to somebody else, they're going to end up taking my job. That's supposed to be the mentality. Everybody with me? Everybody smell what I'm stepping in? So what happens is this. When man doesn't do his job, somebody is going to step up and take his role. And there ain't no such thing but man and woman. So if man's not doing it, the woman is taking on the role that a man's supposed to have. And we wonder why things aren't working the way they're supposed to work. Because men have not done their job. We have failed in society. And it's not my generation. It goes back one to two generations ago. That's when it started. The decline of Western society started with the decline of men doing their job. And because we're not doing our job, the women can't do their job because they're having to do ours. Now, how was that right? How was that love? How was that respecting and honoring and all the cherishing that we're supposed to do for our wives as husbands if we leave them to do our job? That's disrespectful. Look at chapter 6. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may be well with you and that you may live long on the earth. Fathers, don't provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. I believe it's in Colossians. It says, don't exasperate your children. I believe. I'd have to look it up. I forget. It just came to mind. What does it mean to do that? Well, I'll say this. Little girls grow up to marry men like their fathers, and little boys grow up to marry women like their mothers, typically. You look for those same character traits. Okay? Typically. I'm not going to say it's all the time, but it's typical. How about this? Little boys are going to be the husbands that they saw their father's name when they grew up. And little girls are going to marry men that treat their mother, that they're going to marry men like that do the same things their father did. I don't know how to say that any better. So if you don't treat your wife right, your little boy's going to grow up to not be a good husband, most likely not a good father, and your little girl's going to grow up to marry somebody just like you. And that's not a sobering reality. I don't know what it is. You heard the statement, the best thing a man can do for his children is to love their mother. How do we know how to love? Well, the Bible tells us so. We can talk about discipline in the family. Why do you discipline a child? Correct their behavior, wrong. You don't discipline children to correct their behavior. You discipline children to correct their heart. Behavior is a symptom of the root cause, which is a flawed, sinful heart. Because we're all inherently sinful, amen? We're born into sin, because sins have been imputed to us from the garden in Adam and Eve, right? Right? Okay, so if we understand that to be true, then why don't we discipline our children? Their behavior is a symptom of the root cause of their sinful heart. So we discipline to change the heart. Sometimes corporal punishment is needed, but it's not always needed. I've had several conversations with my dog, but he just needs a butt open. No, he doesn't. What would that do? Sometimes a butt open is good. Gets your attention. And it hurts. Makes you think twice before you do it again. That's the point. Everything doesn't need a spanking. I grew up getting a lot of spankings, as you can tell. And for those of you who think I'm heavy-handed, I promise you, relatively speaking, I'm not. But I believe in discipline. In the King James, it says, spare the rod, spoil the child. That's not what that means. It doesn't mean get rid of the rod and spoil. That's not what it means. If you take away the whole counsel of Scripture, it's basically saying, if you spare the rod, you will spoil your child. That's what that premise means. Because all the rest of Proverbs that talks about, it very highly endorses corporal punishment in the book of Proverbs. But what's the purpose of the punishment? The purpose of the punishment is to correct the heart, to change the heart, to promote a change in the heart. So when we discipline when we're angry, are we really doing an effective job? Probably not. You know, my little boy, you guys know Liam, he's a very unique individual. We were at an Amelie softball game a couple months back when you could do such things. He was not being right. Three times that he was just throwing a fit. So I carried him surfboard style from the field to the car, and I was furious. And I had to pop him once just so I could get him surfboard style to walk with me. He was crying, screaming, and everything else. But as I talked to him when we got home, my anger subsided, and I went to sternness and not anger. And I told him when he got home, because of the scene that he made and because of his abhorrent behavior, I didn't use those words, but because you was bad, you didn't listen to me once, you didn't listen to me twice, you didn't listen to me three times, you get three licks with a belt. So I told him. He was crying when we all the way home. It's only like 7.5 miles from Roanoke Park to my house. We got in the house, I took my belt off my work pants, folded it up, I may have bent over his bed, and I popped him three times and I cried the whole time. And the reason I cried wasn't because I was wrong. The reason I cried is because I finally knew what it meant to discipline a child. I finally knew what it meant to change their heart. And he and I cried together after he was spanked. Because I told him I loved him. And I said, I'm doing this thing for you so that you learn what is proper behavior and what is not. And that's what God does to us. That's the purpose of us being here right now. For all you in Facebook land, those of you who are joining us live in person, that's the purpose of sermons, the purpose of reading the scriptures, the purpose of exhortation of the gospel, because all of it goes to train us and discipline us and instruct us in the way we're supposed to live our lives. And us as men have the biggest responsibility of anybody. And I'm not saying that to brag, I wish it wasn't so, but that's the God's honest truth. We have a responsibility, not only to our families, not only to the church, but to the world. And if we can't start right in the family, we'll never get to the church, we'll never get to the world. If we think we can accept Jesus Christ and sit on our butts on our laurels and not do anything, and not train our children in the way in which they should go, and we can drain and corral and do a bunch of other foolishness, which is exactly what it is, then we're never going to make it. And our kids are never going to make it either. And if we measure success by how much money we have or how much stuff we have, and that's what we teach our children, but we don't teach them how to love, honor, and revere, and respect God, then we have failed. We have failed. I don't care who lives where or what you have, because I know people that have more money than anybody in this community. I've been to a house where a guy had a 175-kilowatt generator on his roof. And for those of you who know how big he didn't have an AC system in his house, he had a 4-story house with a 7-stage chiller plant on his roof. I promise you, if he didn't teach his children how to love, honor, and respect God by living a lifestyle, he failed his children, regardless of how much money he's going to leave. Conversely, there's people who have plenty, and they train their children to fear and love and reverence God And they leave their children fortunes, and their children get it. Because they don't care if they have millions or nothing, they still will love, honor, and revere God. That's success. You know, I'm reminded frequently when I preach stuff like this, people say, I want the truth. And I'm reminded of Jack Nicklaus and a few good men. You can't handle the truth. And the fact of the matter is, men, we cannot handle the truth of the matter. Because it all boils down with our relationship with God and where it's at. You want to gauge your success in life? Look in the mirror and ask yourself, have we followed God's instructions? And if the answer is no, then we failed. It does not matter what we have, where we've been, what job we have, none of that matters. And I wish, I'm starting to feel like Paul, that when I look at people and they look at me and they listen to these messages and they hear them and they refuse to change their lifestyles, what hurts me the most is I would gladly give up my life so they could live their life right. You know how painful it is to see people throw it away? Because I will tell you one thing. There are two certainties in this life. Hell is hot, and heaven is real. And based on our choices in this life, I don't care what's come out of your mouth, our actions will dictate where we're going. And if our lifestyle doesn't reflect something that the Bible looks at and says this is how you're supposed to live, there's a good chance you're not going to heaven. There's a good chance you're going to be sweating for eternity. Amen. We can profess with Christ our mouth because we say we believe so someone will get off our back because grandma wants us to be saved. But if we don't truly honestly believe it, and if we don't truly honestly desire to live a life reflective of what the scriptures teach, it's not my place to judge. But you're going to stand in front of Jesus Christ one day, you're going to have to give an account. And I hate to say it, there's a lot of people who think they're going to heaven, they're going to go straight to hell. That's the end of the sentence, because the Bible tells us that. And I would hate to believe that us as men are going to stand, even if we're Christian, before the judgment, and have to answer for why we didn't do what we were supposed to do, why we weren't good stewards, and we're going to have to answer for that. Just because we're saved and going to heaven doesn't mean we're still not going to have to answer for not being a good steward. So I ask you, always. I ask you one question. Where do you stand? Where do we stand? If you read this whole Bible, you will see starting in Genesis 12, one man that God makes a promise to. And the majority of this Bible is written how God fulfilled that promise to that one man. And then you have this thing called the New Testament that comes along, and God's still fulfilling that promise to that one man. Through his seed, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. Who's the seed? Jesus. Huh? And all the nations of the earth will be blessed. And then the rest of the New Testament is all instructions, mostly by Paul and John, teaching the people the very precepts and concepts that were in the Old Testament. Right? And 2,000 years later, what are we still doing? The same thing. Until we as fathers step up to the plate and take our responsibility seriously, our society is going to continue to spiral down. Our families are going to continue to fall apart. Our country is going to go implode on itself because men are too preoccupied with stuff and pride. And the Bible says pride goes before the fall. We are too preoccupied with what we want as selfish human beings than what's best for other people. You know, pastors joke a lot of times. They say, on Mother's Day, fathers get beaten with a stick, and on Father's Day, the dads get beat with a stick. Because they preach Mother's Day message that dads won't do enough, and Father's Day, they get the same message that dads won't do enough. Maybe we should preach every Sunday that dads won't do enough. Maybe then one day the message will be clear. You know, I struggle also because not just here but other places. Pastor, would you talk to my son, my grandson, my niece, my nephew, whatever? Why? They don't listen to you. What makes you think they're going to listen to me? Why don't they listen to you? Maybe you lorded it over them when you were their father. That's why they don't listen to you. Maybe you beat them down and broke their spirits. They don't want to have nothing to do with you. Or maybe you were too lax and let them do what they wanted. It's a fine line. There's no perfect cookie cutter approach for each individual person other than following the Bible. That's the cookie cutter right there. I put that away. I'm still preaching. I could preach on this all day long. And you know what the funny thing is? The irony is, all of you would probably sit here and listen to it all day long because you know it's all true. It's amazing to me that even before the pandemic, our church sat about half empty on a regular basis when we preached the truth, because what we're told is people want the truth. People want it, but they can't handle it. That's the thing when I make a statement about Jack Nicholson and a few good men. People want the truth, but they can't handle it, so they don't come. You follow what I'm saying? They want to eat the truth. They want to know what the truth is, but the fact is they know what the truth says, and they choose to reject it, so they don't come. They want the truth, they know what the truth is, but they choose not to apply it, so they don't come. Why do you want to be constantly reminded of yourself as a failure? Nobody does. Because they're prideful. But the moment we show humility, the moment we bow on our knee and realize that we don't have all the answers, is the very moment that God can do something in our lives. When we make it about Him and not about ourselves, we've actually taken one step forward. So, we're going to have an invitation. I'm going to move this because I anticipate some people coming up, myself included. We're going to have an invitation. Brittany, when you're playing this, if you see people, just cycle it back through if you would. But I want to offer you right now, wherever you're at, Facebook land, here, church, whatever the case may be, if you have business to do with Jesus, whether you want to pray, whether you want to come repent, whether you want to come give your life to Christ, whatever it may be, I pray right there in your living room or in your store, wherever you're at home, watching on Facebook, or whether you're here, you come forward, if you're at the altar or pews, whatever you want to do, you come and you do business with Jesus Christ. I promise you, when you leave from wherever you're at, if you do business honestly and sincerely with Jesus Christ, you'll be a changed person. Even if it's just to pray and say, forgive me. Even if that's all you can do, say, forgive me. Because Romans tells us that the Holy Spirit prays with us for us with groanings and utterings that we cannot understand. When you don't know how to pray, the Holy Spirit prays for you. If you have the Holy Spirit. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, you can fix that too. You can come to know Jesus Christ right now today. In your home, wherever you're at. I don't even have to be there. You can do it all by yourself. All you gotta do is pray and say, God, forgive me. Come into my life and lead me and direct me. And He'll do it. Let's pray together. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank You today for a very humbling message. Humbling for so many ways. The truth of the matter is that men are needed in society. And the sad reality is men have been removed effectively from society. They've either removed themselves or they're fought daily to be removed from positions in society. Or they choose not to be in society. But that's a heart problem, it's a sin problem, a pride problem. So I pray that today if anybody needs to make a decision, man, woman, child, whatever, pray that they come. Pray that they come. They need to pray. I pray that they come. If they want to pray at the altar, at the foot of the cross, the symbolism here is that the closer you come to the front of the church, the closer you get to God. I get that. They can come. They can pray. People at home who aren't here, they want to drive to their church and pray. They can do that too. But if they want to pray wherever they are, I pray that they do. I pray that the Holy Spirit moves as He will, and He convinces. convicts the people of their sinfulness, and they have a desire to reconcile with you. We thank you and we praise you for this opportunity today. And as we have this song of meditation, reflection, and invitation, I pray that people come and they handle their business with you. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's all stand together. We will. And we'll have a hymn, contemporary music. And as you feel led, come. As you feel motivated and desiring, come. You ever have those moments where you can just sit and meditate for several minutes in silence? When you think about the model that God has been to us as our Father, is it not appropriate for us to emulate and mimic that? So the challenge goes forth that today on Father's Day, a day that we celebrate fatherhood, maybe we should celebrate God as our Father and try to be more like Him. So I challenge all you men out there. Be the husbands and fathers that God's called you to be. And if you need help and guidance in understanding that, there's a whole book. It gives you a whole bunch of practical knowledge and information on how to do just that. And there are several Christian scholars that have written several books about family discipleship, about raising children, about training children the way in which they should go. Everybody has free agency to do what they want. But I would dare say the best blessing that any father could get is when a child comes back and says, thank you. Or when his spouse turns to him and says, thank you. Dads really aren't hard to figure out. Get us a car and make us feel good, we're good to go. But let's be mindful of the instructions God's given us. And let's be mindful of the challenge that we have before us. Because we can choose the easy road or we can choose the hard road. And the hard road is to do what's right. It always has been and always will be. Let's pray together. Father God, as we go this week and we depart from here, I pray that even though it may have been hard and hard to hear and harsh, I pray that we're uplifted and encouraged. Because we know that one key thing remains, and that's you. You are steadfast, immovable, and consistent. And I pray that each of us here today, and those watching and those that will watch, will be not only lifted up and encouraged, but will be challenged to be better. And the men out there, I pray, were challenged to be better husbands and better fathers. Not to be better, but to be like you. Because if we strive to be like you, we'll be infinitely better than we ever were. Be with us this week as we go and bless us. Lift us up and encourage us. Lift your face upon us and give us peace. And it's in Jesus' name we pray.